Hey, thank you. So, good afternoon, everyone. Hope everyone is having a good day. So now let's discuss and let's share some information about fall, right? To start, I would like to just to maybe share some thoughts why this pass is quite unique, it's quite particular. Basically, I would like to highlight 3 points here, which the first one is about the capacity of this pass to damage a wide range of crops, right? So there are in the literature more than 200 plant species that this pest can damage because it's polyphagous, right? Dispersion capacity is very important as well, and this makes this pest quite particular as well. So it's a strong flyer, can migrate hundreds of kilometers. One single female moth can fly more than 100 kilometers, right, during one single night, and about 500 kilometers during its life. So it's quite a lot, right? And the eating damage is very high, right? So the bigger is the larva, the bigger is the impact as well on the crops. So now let's see how this pest is spread. As you know, fall comes from Americas, right? If you look here, South America, Latin America, and North America, we have this pest there for many years. And then this pest migrated to Africa. And for 2 years, the pest completely dominated the whole continent. And after that, migrated to APAC. Right. So now let's give a zoom at the APAC condition to see how the situation is in Asia Pacific, right? So as you know, first fall reached India in July 2018, and then after that, the pest start migrating to other neighboring countries, still in South Asia. After that, this pest continue migrating to Southeast Asia country just after a few months after that. And even countries where we are not thinking that would be likely infested, like Northeast Asia countries like Korea, Japan, and Taiwan, they are infested as well with this pest, right? And then lately, fall has reached Australia, as you are aware on that. So going forward, I would like to share some information about U.S. because I think there are some commonalities, right, between U.S. and Australia, mainly in terms of the weather conditions and the crop system as well. So, if you look here, if you look at fall, right, the insect cannot survive extended periods of freezing temperature, right? However, there are some phase that, like eggs and pupa, that can survive even frost conditions, right? But basically, the message here is the populations, they in this condition, right, they are raised in the warmer conditions, like you are seeing here, the red bubble and the blue bubble, right? On the red color, you see the T population, that means Texas haplotype profile, which is the population that came from Central America to Argentina, the population that also are the same from Brazil. And the blue one, you see the F population, which is the Florida haplotype profile, which is composed by the Florida and Caribbean population, right? So these two populations keep multiplying here, as you can see on the warmer condition here, Texas and Florida. And every summer they migrate towards to the Corn Belt area. The Corn Belt is up here on the greener part here. Most of the U.S. corn production is based, right? It's a very cold area. However, during summer, we still have fall pressure there. So this is one implication that we need to consider as well for Australia. Now let's travel to Brazil. It's a completely different scenario. Brazil is a tropical country, it's a big country as well. And you can see here the crop system impacts a lot, right? One thing you really need to pay attention and consider is the crop system. As you see here, we have a lot of crops, right? Brazil is mostly about soybeans, corn, and sugarcane. So summing these three crops, we have about 55 million hectares. And besides this, we have other crops like vegetables and coffee as well. So that means we don't have a strong winter there, and the pest has food, right, all year long. So this makes the environment completely favorable for this pest. Now, let's take one example about corn. If you look to corn, right? Before 2008, we used to have conventional corn. 2008, we launched the first BT corn, right, variety. To manage fall on corn, on conventional corn, is very challenging. Why? Because by that time, we didn't have any seed treatment option, and we are basically relying on foliar-applied insecticides. So this means growers, by that time, they were doing 4 to 6 sprays in the early days from emergency to 35, 40 days, which is quite a lot, right? And then in 2008, the BT 11 was approved in Brazil, and then growers, they migrated. There was a very high adoption. In 1-2 years, almost 100% of adoption migrated from conventional to BT corn. And what happens? There was no refugee, no use of refugee, no IPM, you know, no use of integrated pest management at all. What's happening then? After 3 years, the technology was completely broken, right? So we lost this trait because of the growers were relying too much on the trait, on the single tool. And that's why we lost that. So that was a big learning for us, right? Moving forward now to Africa, I think Africa as well is a quite a particular condition. It stays more or less, if you look in the tropical zone, it's more or less the same zone where most of the Asia Pacific countries are, and also the same zone where Brazil is. So climatically speaking, they are more or less similar. FAO was reported that in 2016, right, on the West Africa part first. It took exactly 2 years for the pest to dominate the whole country. So now many crops are being damaged by fall. And the key challenge there is about, because Africa, because of 2 points, right? The first point is about basically is dominated by smallholders, and the technology, the level of technology adoption is too low. One thing that's making the difference there is the collaboration work that the private and public companies, they are doing together with local governments. So this sort of approach is helping a lot local farmers to cope with fall. Okay, coming back now, coming to the chemistry part, right? What about chemistries? Because I think that was one of the requests to share. We'd like to share this overview about how effective is one synthetic insecticide, right, against fall, based on what we know, right? So we are mentioning here not all, but the key ones are the most relevant ones. I would like first to highlight we need to be aware that the populations that came from Brazil or from Central America, they might carry some resistance genes, right? And if we think about the old chemistries like carbamates, organophosphate, and pyrethroids, we might not get reliable results. I heard that in Australia, probably Dr. Ellen will mention something about that. There was some resistance already confirmed against group one insecticide. So we need to be mindful of that because these chemical groups might not be effective, because this will depend on the population. Our suggestion here as a CP company is to focus on the most effective chemical groups, like you are seeing here, for example, Mectin, spinosins, right? Diamides, IGRs, so they are quite highly effective. We have been tested these AIs on the three geographies, Latin America, here in Africa, and also here in Asia Pacific, and we are seeing quite similar, quite consistent results. So if you ask how the efficacy looks like in the field, I'd like to share this picture, which is a real life situation, right? Real condition in the field. So this is a field in Vietnam where fall was there for close to 2 years now from now. And we have seen here fall behaving as an early pest, which is very common, but also as a cutworm, like a grox, right? Once the seedling emerges, the cutworm go there, the fall go there and cuts the base of the seedlings. If you see here, the number of the red flags are the number of gaps. On the right-hand side, you see a check plot. That means no seed treatment. On the left-hand side, you see seed treatment plots. So you can see the benefits in this case, right? And in most of the Asia-Pacific countries, we are seeing something like that. So the pest pressure is becoming at least moderate to high. It will depend, of course, of the season, right? And what about foliar-applied insecticide? If you look at the foliar-applied insecticide, look at this example. This is one field from Lampung, Indonesia, where we have a very high pest pressure on the first year of the pest infestation, right? You can see here the check is completely gone, right? That doesn't mean in all the cases we are going to see this, but this is a very high situation combined as early pest infestation, early foliar pest plus cutworm. You can see here as well on the left-hand side, the pyrethroid plot. You still see plants, but the control is very poor, right? So that's why I told you that we cannot really rely on pyrethroids and OPs because they might not deliver the best control. And if you look at the greener plots or better plots, you see several new technologies that we are developing, like based on diamides, Mectins, and IGRs, So they are quite effective on that pest. Moving forward, the crop program. I think this is the key one. I bring here the example of corn because corn is the key one, right, for us. So our approach in this case is to use a crop program. Why? Because we cannot rely on a single tool, right? We must use an integrated approach. For example, we can use pheromone traps to monitor the adults, and monitoring the adults will help us to better do the field scouting, right? In the future, intensify the field scouting. We can also use seed treatment as a piece of this integrated approach. We can use biologicals, so there are NPV and baculovirus that are effective as well, and there are many more undergoing. And then we use foliar applied insecticide. Once the threshold level is reached, then we can apply accordingly. So this is about the use of frog, which is quite important. And my last note here is about what's the implication for Australia. I would like just to highlight the key points here, right? The fall adaptation. So this is about, the fall is relatively new in Australia, right? Less than, let's say, about 6 months. So let's monitor very closely in the next 1.5 years, because in the first 2 years, the pest takes to have a stabilized adaptation and fully, you can see the damage, the consistency and the pattern of the damage and the crops. So that will be very clear in the next months, I believe. Application time is very critical, regardless of the crop we are considering. This is very important. We need to apply as early as possible, considering the larva as well, the larva size. Bigger larva is difficult to kill, right? We think on the chemistry part, and also in the damage, because if you lose the right momentum, we can compromise the control later on. Also, we need to understand the interaction between GM and non-GM crops, right, with fall. Because even with GM crops, like in Brazil and US, in some cases, we still need to use complementary tools, right, to help the traits as well, because to bring sustainability for that. And the last but not least point is about collaboration. I think what we are doing today is just a starting point, but working together, right, and unifying our strengths, I think the growers will benefit a lot from that, right? We can learn together and we can address better the solutions and the way we can really manage fall. Because in my opinion, fall came to stay, right? And this pest will stay. It will be very difficult to be, you know, free of this pest from now onwards. So we need to learn how to convive and how to manage this in a sustainable way. So many thanks for your time. And if you have any questions, please use the chat box. We are available here. Okay, thank you.